Good day to all of you. I spent a wonderful week in Dharamshala with the absolutely fascinating Tibetans. I did a 1 week workshop for the counselors of Tibetan schools from all over India and Nepal. So we had this wonderful time. I stayed with them in their place and we did rigorous sessions from morning to evening. And then we had very, very tiring flights both ways. All four flights were late. Finally, late night, I landed up here just in time so that I can be with you all today. And in all this, I was only using my own intelligence. I was not using artificial intelligence anywhere. Okay, before I come to the main topic, I want to share with you a very, very intriguing incident that I went through many, many years back. There were these friends of mine from my college days who had started a credit cooperative society for poor people. You know, those street side vendors, hawkers, those type of people. They used to give them interest-free loans so that they can continue with their business, and they used to pay back all that was happening. At one point, they decided, why not provide some very cheap housing? These were the days before housing loans were given by banks, before HDFC came in and all that. So poor people, particularly, they never had any means unless they had the full money to buy an apartment, they couldn't have. So they decided that why not go out of the city to a remote suburb and offer them this one-room apartment at a very, very manageable price on installments. So they went, they hunted around, they found a very good location, and a huge tract of land was owned by one man. He had inherited all these lands for many generations. He himself was quite old. And he had this huge tract of land. They went and told him that it is for this cause. We are going to be building for poor people. And he was very happy. And he negotiated with them and gave them a very reasonable price. And they also negotiated that since we can't pay upfront and buy off the whole thing, so we will take possession of one portion of your land, pay you so much money, continue paying you till we have completed this portion. Then you give us some more land. Then we keep paying you for that. Like that, we'll keep on building these apartments. They told me, since I was at that time into projects and construction and all that, but I was not in Bombay. So they told me that, can you please take over the management of this, the construction part of it? I said, sure, that's my forte. I have a very good team and I have very nice people. I will definitely do that. I even went and saw the place when I was visiting Bombay. I got some soil testing and all that done. And I told them, okay, now you can go ahead and sign. When you get the land, then starts the process of designing the building, then getting approval from the municipal authorities, then all those processes, and then the construction will come. So I knew I still have many months ahead of me before I actually have to do anything for them. And I had a lot of other commitments with which I was busy. When these people finished their negotiation with the old man, and when everything seemed to be set and they would be signing, he suddenly said, who is actually going to get this construction done? Who is the person who's going to supervise over your project? They told him about me, that he's our very old friend and he's this, he's an engineer from IIT, he's like this, like that, everything they explained. And he's doing a lot of projects in Hyderabad. And he's willing to come and get the thing going and supervise over and visit periodically and get some trusted engineers to look after the project, all that they explained. The old man said, I want to meet him. They said, why do you need to meet him? He's not part of the deal. We are the people who are negotiating this deal. Only when the land is, the deal is signed, and then when we get the approvals and we do the design, then he comes into the picture. Right now, he has nothing to do. Old man insisted. He said, no, I want to meet this person before I sign the deal. They called me up and I was really quite busy. In fact, it was peak, summer time when trains were all full. Those days we never used to fly. Trains were all full. Reservation was not available. And I had so many commitments. But they said, the old man is refusing to sign unless he meets you. Okay. So I gave up everything, somehow managed to get into a train, got just seating accommodation, went overnight, reached in the morning, went to my brother's house and dumped my bag over there, caught a local train, went all the way out to that suburb called Mumbra. There they received me and they took me to this site. We went and sat down and he started asking very general questions. Oh, what do you do? Where are you? Something like that. How is the weather there? And then he started asking, what type of food do you eat there? How's your this thing? What are the things? A very, very general question, nothing to do with what we are supposed to be discussing. Okay. And at one point he said, would you like to have a cup of tea? I said, no, thank you, because it was nearing 1 o'clock and I had had just a very minimal breakfast. So I said, no, thank you, sir. I have not even had proper breakfast and I've been traveling overnight. So as soon as our meeting is over, I'll go and have my lunch. So I don't want to spoil my appetite by having tea. He said, oh, you've not had proper breakfast? You come all the way to our city and you are here with me in my house? And how can it be that I send you away without food? Just give me a little while. I'll see to it that my wife cooks very good food and gives it to you. She's already ready with the food. I'll ask her to make some extra dish or something and we'll give it to you. I said, no, please. Let's finish the discussion. I will go. There are hotels outside. I'll go and eat. No, 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 no. You're my guest. How could that be? And all that. Anyway, we sat down. And again, he started making some small talk about this, that. Nothing to do with the project. The food came. I finished the food and everything. And then this man gets up and shakes hands with me and says, okay, you can go. And I thought that, he wants to call off because he's not talking about the project. And these people turned to him and said, so then what next? He said, tomorrow morning, come to my lawyer's place at such and such time and bring whatever the documents and agreements, everything with you. I will make the lawyer go through the thing and tomorrow we'll sign the agreement. Again, I was shocked. If that was the case, then why did he call me all the way just to give me lunch? One of our team members, of that group, he was a little mischievous fellow. He couldn't restrain himself. As we were going out, he was the last one there near the door. He said, Sahibji, please don't feel bad my asking. But you made this man come all the way just to give him lunch and talk about weather and traffic and something, and then now you're saying we'll go ahead. He said, yes, son. I go by people. I want to see this person. I want to talk to this person, interact with this person. I have lived 75 years in this world. I can talk to a person for half an hour and make out what are his characteristics, what is his value system and morals, what is his attitude towards people. And if he is going to be the person on the spot, getting this construction and all that done on my land, I want to know whether I am in safe hands. That's why I caught him. It was an eye-opener that there are people like this, who have got this wonderful instinct. This is what, according to me, intelligence is all about. Today, what do? We want to find out about somebody. We Google him. We check him on LinkedIn and we check him on Facebook and then we check this and we do that and we, find out all these things. But we don't sit face to face and have a talk and try to use our own brain to find out what is happening. That is what has happened in the last maybe 3 decades or more. Okay, so coming to the main topic. First thing is, let me tell you, I know nothing about artificial intelligence. My area of interest is only in the second half of the title, that is our own intelligence. But to have, an objective comparison, let me pull out, I went through a lot of definitions of artificial intelligence. The one which I liked most was that artificial intelligence strives to build machines that can mimic human behavior and carry out human-like tests, tasks. Human intelligence seeks to adapt to new situations by combining a variety of cognitive processes. This I found to be the best comparative definition of artificial and human intelligence. Okay. Also, remember that AI, artificial intelligence, lacks things like creativity and intuition which humans possess intrinsically. It is limited by programming. It does not adapt to new unexpected situations. That's what they say, don't ask me. You may argue against it and say, no, even machines can adapt and all that. I won't go into that argument. It may make errors if not programmed and trained properly. This is what I saw as possible definition. Now, we all know that human intelligence has creativity. Most of us are creative in some way or the other. And I think by now, I need not repeat that creativity is nothing to do with art and design and dance or music or something. Those also definitely require creativity. But creativity can be in computer programming. Creativity can be in negotiating a sales deal. Creativity can be in designing your house. Anywhere creativity comes in. So human intelligence has creativity and, of course, intuition. I don't know how much artificial intelligence has developed intuition, but human beings have it. Only those who do not allow their intuition to give them some little advice and give them a little bit of inputs here and there, only their intuition goes down. Otherwise, it is there naturally. You don't have to even work and build on it. Human intelligence includes what we call as emotional intelligence. And the most important aspect of the five pillars of emotional intelligence, empathy. I don't know how much artificial intelligence can develop empathy, if not now, in future and all that. I don't know. I leave it to those people who are in that thing. Human beings can adapt to new and unexpected situations. They can have ethical and moral considerations. If we are giving up on this very important area, if we are allowing artificial intelligence to intrude on these areas, I think we are making a very fundamental mistake. Also, don't forget that human intelligence has been built over millions of years through experiences, evolution, survival of the fittest, as they say. It has taken a lot. I don't know how much artificial intelligence has developed in the last 20 years. The question is, are we willing to give it up? I don't have any negative thoughts towards artificial intelligence, because I've realized that any new technology cannot be fought against them. I believe in the adage, if you cannot win them, join them. And that's what I do whenever I see something new. I say, come on, let's join hands and see what we can do. My only consideration is that the more we are relying on artificial intelligence, the less we are relying on our own intelligence. And you know that very good quote which says, use it or lose it. Any skill that you have, you may be a good cook, you may be good at riding a bike or driving a car, you may be good in computer programming, you may be good in anything, but if you don't use that skill, slowly what happens? You lose it. And this has been told to us a number of times in different ways by important people who say that even a very, very horrifying disorder called dementia, Alzheimer's disease, hits people who do not use all parts of your brain. Science has always progressed. Science has always brought new things which have made life easier and easier for us. But the question is, if you start relying on that science and technology, and if you lose your own, I'll give you a simple example. There was a time long back when people, almost everybody had to walk, or at the most they would have a horse or a bullock cart or whatever it is. But most of the time people would be walking. Then we got automobiles, right? Today, almost every person, if not an automobile, at least a bike or a scooter or some moped, everybody has some vehicle. So most of the time now we don't walk. We either use our own vehicle or we use public transport. We may use the metro, we may use buses, we may use, you know, cabs. The point is that the walking that we do has significantly reduced. But we still walk. We walk within the house. We walk to the nearest place. Sometimes we walk down to the metro station or wherever we have to catch a bus or something like that. So we do not lose the skill of walking. If that is there, I'm happy. But what are the threats of artificial intelligence? Take a simple thing like Google Maps. I thoroughly enjoy when I'm sitting with some friends in a vehicle and they don't even want to look up or look around to see what landmarks are there and where we are going and where we are going to reach. They're only staring at the phone, which is showing you that red line moving this side, that side. And they are listening to that cute lady who speaks in that American accent and says, after 500 meters, turn right. And we only keep following that. Here is a wonderful world that we are traversing through. But we don't even want to look outside. And this I can really reinforce to you because I spent this whole week surrounded by mountains of the height and the, you know, magnitude which I could never dream of. Being a typical South Indian, I used to think mountains is the Western Ghat or the Nilgiris or whatever it is. They look like tiny ants in front of the mountains that we saw on the foothills of the Himalayas. Okay, now the question is that do I want to give up all that and only restrict myself to the 6 inches of the phone? If you are doing that, and this is only one example that I'm giving you, if you are doing that, you are going to be in trouble. And I speak to the people of the next generation after me. You've already had very good examples of tsunamis, earthquakes, and the COVID pandemic. Each of these was not only beyond your control, it was totally unexpected. Nobody dreamt that a tsunami will happen, or an earthquake will happen, or COVID will happen. So are we not now wise enough to wake up to say, why are we not using our own intelligence? I remember, there was a wonderful architect who had come from Europe and settled down in India called Laurie Baker. When he went to the foothills of Himalayas where an earthquake had taken place, he immediately decided to teach the villagers how to make earthquake-proof houses. They looked very shabby. They looked very, very, very unpermanent, as you say. But they withstood any earthquake after that. That is what I call as real intelligence. Anyway, just to get an idea about what is happening in the world, I may be an outdated person or an ignorant person. I thought, let me ask how artificial intelligence is affecting people. So we did a quick survey, the usual Google survey. We don't have any other choice. And we asked a few hundred people, 4 basic simple questions about artificial intelligence. Okay. That has been collated and Sonal has made it into a nice, pie chart, as we call it. I will show these 4 to you one by one. The first one, the question that we ask is artificial intelligence useful in your life? People who said it is 100% useful were about a quarter, 26%. They said it is 100% useful, in meaning to say, I can't do without AI. People who said 50%, sometimes it is useful, sometimes it is not, were a huge chunk, 40%. People who said 10% or even less than 10% were about one third. About one third people said that it is hardly useful. 40% people said it is quite useful, and the balance said it is absolutely 100% useful. The second question that we asked was, Do you think artificial intelligence will control human beings? This is that big debate going on. No, will machines become more intelligent than us? Then will they rule over us and all? Science fiction shows us so much. Anyway, I wanted to see what's the belief of the common man, the Indian common man. Can you believe it? That 31% actually believe that AI will control us. They will become our masters. 46% said, no, that will not happen. And of course, 21% said, I don't know, it may or may not happen. But please keep in mind that as many as 1/3 of the people actually believe that artificial intelligence will one day control human beings. The third one is, how much are you building your own intelligence? What efforts are you making to build up your intelligence? About 10% said, no, I'm not doing anything. I'm happy with the way it is. I don't need to further improve my intelligence. And out of the balance, 90%, half of them said little and half of them said lots. I appreciate the people who said lots, who said that I am building my own intelligence in whatever form. Because it has now been proven that intelligence is not a fixed thing. You can improve on it if you make efforts. How, what, where, we will discuss in some other forum. And the last one that I asked was, can you imagine life without artificial intelligence? Supposing artificial intelligence disappears from the face of the earth. Do you think life will continue as it is, and can you visualize? I'm happy that 60% said yes. But a quarter of the people said no. I cannot imagine life without AI, meaning to say that I'm already a slave of artificial intelligence. I am so addicted to it, I'm so dependent on it, that I cannot imagine life without AI. 1/4 of the respondents said that. Of course, 18% said, I don't know. That's fair enough. So this is just to give an idea of what is happening among people around us in our own society and the way things are going. There is one very important thing which I just wanted to tell you. Since, as I said, I have absolutely no idea. I'm not an expert in it and all that. But one thing that I came to know, which I thought, in case you don't know, all of us should know. And that is, I'll just read it out to you. I want a light. I'm not able to see. I want you to be aware of it in case you're not aware. Okay. It says, the terms of use of open AI website state that you are surrendering your rights, title, and interest in anything that you share with them or give your comments. You're surrendering your rights. They can use it in any way they wish. So that is one. Which media also does sometimes. Newspaper people say, if you're giving a comment or if you're writing an article, we have the rights over it. Fair enough. To that extent, I would have said, okay, let them have it. But if you open any open AI product, that is ChatGPT and all that, you cannot question in any way the results generated by them. That means you can't use your own intelligence. You cannot question them. If you do, you are violating the intellectual property rights of open AI, even if you question them, mind you. Though you may have signed away your own IP, your own intelligence, you have signed away. Anything that you have said, anything that you have typed or given inputs, you have signed it away. But you cannot question anything that they are saying. You cannot show your dissent on that. You are subject to sanctions imposed by the company and, more importantly, by the US government. Can you imagine that? Give a serious thought to this. Why are we surrendering ourselves when we, the human race, took millions of years to evolve, to grow, to develop from very ordinary creatures, Homo sapiens, to the point today where we rule the world? And are we doing things to voluntarily surrender this? I will also tell you one, you know, significant thing which I feel is a threat. There are people who say that no, machines can never control human beings. They have this concept of pulling the plug. So if a machine is trying to get over smart or trying to overtake, all you need to do is to pull the plug and that's it. The machine is gone. It's like taking a sword and chopping off the neck and there you are, your enemy is gone. But what these people are not understanding is, go back into history. Even when wars were won or lost, it was not the most powerful, the strongest and the bravest army that won. A lot of such armies lost because of intrigue, politics, traitors. So if there is one human being with his human intelligence who decides to team up with artificial intelligence only to overcome his enemy or to put down his competition, it is so easy for him to, like you would have read in history that there was this very big fort, impregnable fort, and the king was sitting happy inside saying that no enemy can breach this, my ramparts of my fort and get in. Nobody can, you know, overtake me or conquer me. And his own trusted general in the middle of the night goes down and opens the gates. And the enemy troops who are ready, they just pour in, kill the king's troops, take over. So my question is not competition between artificial intelligence and human intelligence, but the basic fundamental question of, will this new tool in the hands of human beings give an opportunity to people to play against each other using artificial intelligence, which is going to be in the days to come a very, very powerful and invincible tool? Will a human being use his basic human intelligence only to climb over somebody's shoulder, to put somebody down, to destroy somebody also if necessary? One classic example of that happened last year. United States of America, which is the most supposedly developed country, it has got the highest network of flights. They say in their topmost airports, one flight takes off or lands every 60 seconds, throughout 24 hours. Now, in a situation like that, they control the skies, right? They have everything in control. But one fine day last year, you can Google it and see it happened, that no flight was able to take off from any airport in the United States of America. And that situation lasted the whole day. It took one full day for people to set it right. And only by evening, flights resumed. Just give a thought to the helplessness of an entire nation which cannot move because something has gone wrong in the technology which controls the flights and the airports and all that. We have much more to go. It is up to us. If we understand the basic thing that technology can be a very nice slave, but a horrible master. And more so if it becomes a slave in the hands of our competitors, our enemy, people who don't like us, then we can really be in trouble because we are sort of handing over AK-47s and hand grenades and all that to anybody and everybody freely, not knowing who will use it against us. Keeping this in mind, I'm going to take my 1 minute break. Poornima is here. She was with us in the lovely salubrious MacLeod Ganj and Dharamshala, and we have come back and she's also back with us. Let us see what she has to share with you.
Hi, good afternoon. And we are back from Dharamsala, Himachal Pradesh, the land of the holy Himalayas, and such a beautiful place. So we were doing a 5 full days project for the Tibetan counselors and explaining to, you know, the it was a workshop, but one of them in their feedback, you know, what they wrote, sir, you are calling this a workshop of 5 days. I will call it a journey of 5 days. And from here it begins. So good afternoon, all of you all. Thank you for the nice good afternoon messages. Yes. And so that is what the, you know, program was. It was a 5 days program, and so pure, so pristine. And when you look at the Himalayas, you are so chotu, yeah. Oh my God, it just makes you so humble. It just brings you to earth when, you know, we went there. And from the place where we were, which is a central Tibetan administration office and things like that, you know, around that area. And their training center is there. So from there, you feel you can touch the mountains. And it is so huge, clad with clouds and everything. Fantastic. So that is our intelligence that we used in that place. So it was on understanding the, you know, skills and habits of adolescents. So it was a marathon session, but a very meaningful one, and a place so pure, so green, and makes you feel so you know, down to earth when you are just before those mountains. So that is the news from out of Bangalore. And what is going to happen in Bangalore? I'll request Anis, if she can put up the poster. This is our postgraduate diploma in psychotherapies. See, what happens is there are quite a few who do various other, you know, they pick up various other academics and educational qualifications and things like that. But somewhere we meet so many people who say that, oh, I wish I knew something of psychology because that was my calling, but I had to do this or I had to do that other career option for various reasons. So what we have done is at Banjara, we have brought together a course, and this is the 6th or 7th year that this course is on. It is called, as the name is here, Postgraduate Diploma in Psychotherapies. This year, we have gone a step further and opened it up to all graduates. Earlier, we thought that, you know, we may need a background of psychology or doing a diploma in counseling skills. But this year, we have opened it up to all, so that if someone wants to learn, why stop that person, right? And this can be done from the benefit of home, sitting, and you have the USP of our courses is that you have a mentoring process. So the mentor will be there with you, take you through, but then so unconventional, no textbook, no theories. I mean, not theory, no exam and studying and mugging. The way that you write your comprehensives is so different. The faculty members who are two excellent faculty members, Dr. Chandra and Dr. Lakshmi, they ensure that they find out if you understand where to apply it. That is more important, right? Instead of writing the exact words of the theory and things like that. And they take you through this whole process of understanding the self, the journey. So if you know anyone, or if you think you would just want to do this once a week, 6 months course, here we are enjoying, no, you can enjoy the process of the whole course over online and with mentoring. So that is what is coming up very soon from Monday. Please pass on the message if anyone wants to do it and know more about psychotherapies. And now over to Dr. Ali for all the questions that you may have and all the answers that he is going to give you. Thank you. See you soon.
And back. And I can see a lot of people saying, good afternoon, Purni. Nice to hear Tibet stories. Hi, Purni. Hi, Purni. Everybody keeps saying, hi, Purni. Nobody says, hi, Ali. No, I'm joking. I know what it is. Anyway, we have had a lot of highs and all that. But starting with Parveen, who says, emotions lacking in AI. Now, even that is a little debatable because there is work going on, from whatever I've heard, that AI is also working on emotions. Starting with a thing like they are saying, identifying emotions. They say that there are machines who are able to identify what emotions you are going through. They have these millions of faces and expressions which they categorize and analyze. So if you have a smile, if you look a little in the left direction, if you raise your eyebrows, what is it that you are trying to say? So they are working on it. I have no comments either way, whether they will succeed, whether they will be as good or better than human beings in identifying and dealing with emotions or not. Only time will tell. Okay. Surekha says, as people become more robotic with the use of artificial intelligence, will our emotional intelligence take a beating? Yes, Surekha, you brought out exactly the point that I wanted to emphasize on. And that is that we are giving up certain things which we have. Many of us already have developed in various ways our emotional intelligence. Now, if we stop using it, the same way as I told you, by using Google Maps, it happened to us. We were going to a place in Tamil Nadu and I was sitting with two other gentlemen. Both of them were on their mobiles and their Google Maps and all that. Now, I had been on that highway long back. I had a vague idea that after a certain distance, after so many kilometers, there's a branch of two roads and we should take the left road and not the right road. Now, from the time that I had last been on that highway to now, a lot of flyovers had come, a lot of shops and buildings had come. So topography was totally different. I wasn't very sure. I told them, anyway, we've been traveling for quite some time. Why don't we stop at this junction, have a cup of tea somewhere and inquire with the local fellow which route to take? They said, no, not necessary. We'll go further ahead. It's not even an hour's distance. We'll go there and we'll have our coffee there. And the Google is telling us what to do. And the Google says, go, 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 go. At one time, the Google says, after 1 kilometer, there is a break in the highway. Take a U-turn and travel for 30 minutes. Take a U-turn and travel for 30 minutes. And we realized that is what had happened. We had gone 25 kilometers ahead on a wrong route. And this time when we came back to that junction or that town, I said, nothing doing. We stop here and we ask people. This is an answer to Surekha's question that, you know, are we allowing our emotional intelligence, our decision-making, so many things that come with it, including one of the most important thing that is our empathy. Are we allowing it to go down? Okay, Veena says, few years back, Volvo bus from Bangalore to Chennai caught fire, but people could have escaped easily, could not because of automatic lock system. Yes, I had also heard of that tragedy, Vina, and it has happened not only in that bus. There have been people in their own cars. They have been locked in and suffocated to death because the locks just refused to open. So here we have got such excellent vehicles which are airtight. They don't allow the outside atmosphere to come in and they give you the highly effective air conditioning and all that. But if something jams and locks up, which is artificial intelligence, because the car decided that I'm not going to allow the owner to take his decision of opening the door of the car, something as basic as that. These are things which we seriously need to look into. Surekha says, if we use artificial intelligence as an aid, it will strengthen us. But if we use it as a crutch, it can cripple our natural intelligence. Exactly, that is what I'm saying. If you say I have to go a long distance, I will use my car to go. But when I have to go a short distance, I will walk down. Why should I take my car. But if you decide to make it a crutch, that I cannot step out anywhere without my vehicle, then you are going to be at a loss, isn't it? Alka says, hi Alka, good to see you back after a long time. Alka has been a very dear friend of Banjara and she's doing excellent work as a counselor. Alka says, this course is amazing. I'm lucky that I have done through Banjara. Yes, she's referring to the course which Purnima had said sometime back, our postgraduate diploma in psychotherapies. So people keep hearing, you know, that there's this particular psychotherapy, that particular psychotherapy, there is CBT, there is REBT, there is all these things. What are they all about? At a very basic fundamental level, that's what this course, you know, takes you through. Veena says, Ali West believes more in process than human, my thoughts. Yes, Veena, it is a fact. We are seeing a lot of things happening in the West which are not very, very gratifying. And there are times when I really think that we are very lucky to have been born and brought up in the East where we still preserve our own thinking, cultures, value systems and all that. And I hope, regardless of any artificial intelligence, we don't let go of that. Navina says, human intelligence cannot be replaced. But at the same time, it's important to know when to take help from artificial intelligence and when to use human intelligence. In fact, one of the recent experiments which was done to replace human intelligence was self-driven cars. From the time cars were invented 150 years back, every car needed a driver. Now we came out with driverless cars. The car drives itself. And you saw what the initial repercussions were. I think they are still struggling. I don't know whether they will succeed or they will not. But they are making efforts to replace human beings. Today it is drivers. Tomorrow it will be accountants. Day after tomorrow it will be engineers. Day after that it may be doctors. And can you imagine yourself, you've fallen sick and a robot or a machine takes over your treatment with no human involved? Think of that scenario. Kanchana says, very good afternoon, good information about AI. And Purni, good afternoon, very useful message with a smiling face. Yes, that's true. Okay, Vinita says, Ali, sometimes I feel our dependency also increases on AI than on our intelligence. As you mentioned, that we are not using our brains to our potential. It happens with bodies, it happens with brains. Bodies, I give you an example of walking, an example of exercise. The other day, a very eminent doctor was telling me that there was a time when all our limbs, everything we used to exercise on a regular basis when we were living in the village, walking, jumping, lifting weights, bending over. We used to do everything. Every part of our body used to be exercised. He said, not what we are doing is, we go to the gym, have a rigorous workout for 1 hour, and the balance 23 hours we spend either sleeping or sitting in front of our laptop with no exercise to any part of the body. He says, it is very, very dangerous to do that. And that is why we've had some very tragic instances of people who are very fit and fine and who are gymming every day and they just collapsed and died. Keep these things in mind. Asha says, is our ego coming in the way that we are aligning to use machine to avoid human touch? Yes, Asha, ego could be there. It could be a desire to progress, a desire to, you know, learn more and more or to get more of whatever our goals and our desires are. There's no limit to it. Everybody has their own reason why to do that. But if you noticed, Asha used a very, very important thing. Are we aligning to use the machine to avoid human touch? Human touch, I feel, is just not replaceable in any way. Can you imagine you come back home tired after whatever you've done outside and you have a robo who comes and, you know, hugs you and puts you in his or her lap and says sweet nothings to you? Even by a stretch of imagination, you will never have that feeling which happens from a loved one, right? Surekha also says, will we end up being a more lazier and demotivated race? Lazier, yes. Demotivated, no. In fact, I find people who are so highly motivated, who are such go-getters, who are so enthusiastic, and these people I keep meeting throughout. Even the few hours that I spent on the airports and in the flights in the last week, while going and while coming, we had a very long journey lasting about 11 hours totally. I was seeing so many people so enthusiastic, so motivated. But the question was that we are motivated to do what? Gain money, gain position, gain status, gain power. There's no limit to it, isn't it? And yes, we are becoming lazier because we want, you see, earlier people who are in a position of wealth and power used to become lazy because they used to ask others to do their work. Now we are, even those others would sometimes protest, would get tired, would have their limitations. But now we are using machines who neither get tired, nor they have any limitations, nor do they have any unionism or something to say, no, I'm not going to do your work for you, right? Okay, Roshan says, always believed in natural things than anything artificial. But now, I also believe with progress of science, and a friend of mine did robotics from US, she's able to perform surgeries with the help of robots. It was amazing with what precision each instrument is brought to conduct the operation. Yes, these are some of the great strides, great advances, great control and power that we have got. But like we were discussing a few minutes back, what happens if the computer or the machine or the robot decides that I will not listen to the surgeon? I have this data bank of 1 million surgeries that have been done in the last 100 years. And based on that, I take a decision. I decide that this should be cut open or that should be left alone or whatever. And that will be done, remember, without empathy, without looking at the human part of the thing. You have to, as it is, if a doctor is very insensitive, the other day somebody was saying that this man is such a great neurologist. He knows everything about the brain, but he forgets that there's a human body attached to the brain. Now, when we can say that to some insensitive human beings, imagine how it is to machines, right? Yes. Navina says, the human touch is so important in anything. Can family support, love, care, and nurses love and care in the hospital? The logic of lawyers, chartered accountants be replaced? No, I think Navina says. It is a very big question mark, Navina. Lot of people are battling it. We have people on both sides of the fence. You saw the little survey that we did and the outcome of it. As it happens with any major issue, there are people on this side of the fence and there are people on that side of the fence. And nobody can predict the future. Navina also says, in fact, Ali, as you mentioned in your first sharing with knowing the person by meeting, that person is so important. In fact, people may state fancy things in Facebook and LinkedIn, but we can know the real person only by meeting, and that creates so much impact. Absolutely right. That's what I personally believe in. Surekha also has a very interesting question. It's a very, very deep question. How will artificial intelligence affect relationships? Surekha, unfortunately, I'm only a counselor and I'm not an astrologer. I cannot predict. But I can point out a few areas where there is a possibility that something can happen. Relationships are... Why go so deep into artificial intelligence? Just the fact that for almost 2 years we had a lockdown and all our communication took place through technology. We were refusing to step out of the house. Ask yourself, how has it affected relationships? And this was a very small drop in the ocean, I would say, as compared to what is going to come to us in the coming few years. Surekha also says, will artificial intelligence generate a more emotionless and insensitive world? We are already headed towards that, Surekha. Day in and day out, I counsel people or interact with people who face such huge walls and resistance when it comes to empathy, when it comes to compassion, when it comes to, you know, a warmth, love, affection. So many people seem to think that that is of no value. Just to give you an example, one of my very close friend of my daughter is a nutritionist, and she has done exceedingly well in her profession. Today, she heads the nutrition department of a very big hospital, and she works very hard. She says, human lives are there in my control. If I, you know, make some mistakes in nutrition and all that, it can have very bad repercussions on the patient. So she's very, very committed. The other day, in some context, she was talking to me about her financial needs and this and that, and she told me, when she told me her salary, I was shocked. I said, the most ordinary software programmer also does not get such a low salary that you are getting. She said, yes, that's how it is in our profession and in our environment. Now, if we do not recognize, if we do not value such people who are doing so much for us, can you imagine tomorrow if you something goes wrong, you're very sick, you're hospitalized, and you have a nutritionist who doesn't understand your needs and prescribes some type of food which can play havoc with your body? You're risking your life with that person, but you don't want to pay the person half as much as you pay to a, let's say, a software programmer or an artificial intelligence technologist or whatever you wanted to call it. Roshan says, robots will be very good for lazy people. Prepare food and also serve them, clean the house, and keep everything in order. Now, this brings me to a very interesting aspect, that will the robot be sensitive enough to look at me and say, I think today he is very tired. He may like to have a very light, maybe curd rice or something which is, you know, not very heavy and which he can eat conveniently. Or today he seems to be very enthusiastic. He's been working hard. He's quite hungry. So today, can I make something which is heavy and filling and very, very tasty? If these robots and all can come to the, they can make excellent food. They can be better cooks maybe than the best of chefs. I don't deny that. But this sensitivity, this understanding, this connections, this is what we need to work on, right? Navina said, I loved your quote, make AI your slave and not your master. Please, all of you, it is my sincere request, keep this in mind. Make sure that in no way technology is becoming your master. Okay. Navina says also, if humans are replaced by machines, in a country like India with so much population, there would be so much poverty, enhancement of crimes, etc. Absolutely right, Navina. Hardly anybody gives any attention to it. The rich-poor divide is growing consistently. India produced the maximum number of dollar millionaires, as we call them, when we were going through the lockdown. Can you imagine that? In the lockdown, literally millions and millions of people starved. They were deprived of their earnings, their salaries, their livelihood. And yet, there were so many people who used their human intelligence, crafty intelligence, to take advantage. And they became millionaires, billionaires. As long as we uphold certain basic values and understand certain, you know, human interactions, no technology is going to help us. No robot is going to make food. When I come back home, is it more important for me to get absolutely the perfect food Or is it more important for me, for some family member who looks at me and says, you look tired. Can I first get you a glass of water? Can I just sit with you and hold your hand and give you a little bit of reassurance? That is what we should not give up under any circumstance, is it? Okay, so with that, let us close the session for the day. A lot of food for thought. Discuss, ask experts who are much more specialized than me on this topic, and you continue this process. It's a topic which we cannot ignore, whether you are on this side of the fence or that side of the fence. We should understand these things. So please keep working on it. Please keep spreading the message. Please keep telling people also who are interested to watch this, even if they can't do it specifically, you know, at Saturday 2 o'clock. As you know, it remains on the Facebook page of Banjara. Anytime, any day, they can log in and they can benefit from it. So that is what we will do now. But before I wind up and hand you over to Anis to do the winding up process, let me remind you of next Saturday's topic. And that is parenting your parents. What does that mean? It means as your parents grow older and you grow into adulthood, and now you are strong, you are earning, you are competent, you have life in your control, your parents have started slowly losing control of their life. So in certain ways, they are becoming children. So sometimes the roles are reversed. So do I need to parent my parents? And if so, how do I do it? If no, what are the consequences? That is what we will be discussing. Please share any inputs or any ideas that you have before next Saturday so that I can include in it. But we shall definitely meet next Saturday at 2 o'clock. Thank you and bye-bye.